हरे कृष्णा, थैंक यू फॉर ज्वाइनिंग वंस अगेन
हरे
टुडे.
कृष्णा.
सो व्हाट इज द टॉपिक यू आर प्लानिंग टू डिस्कस टुडे मेंशनड?
या आई वुड लाइक टू नो योर व्यूज एंड वी कैन आल्सो टुगेदर एक्सप्लोर द टॉपिक ऑफ रेसिज्म. आई केम अक्रॉस दिस पर्टिकुलर प्रेजेंटेशन एंड आई एम बोरोइंग द टाइटल फ्रॉम maybe it was some YouTube video or some article. Racism won't die. Dot dot dot. Racism has to die. So I would explain for the benefit of our audience. When I say racism won't die, what I mean is when we look at the definition of racism, which you can put a like a long sweeping view about how biological, sociological, or racial ways of profiling what or defining what exactly is race has become so difficult, why it is so ambiguous, and it simply won't leave the human experience as far as last, say, 1,000-1,500 years of human history, if we consider that. So that's a part of it won't die. It rears its ugly head. Whether it is Hitler's Germany or Pol Pot's Kampuchea or Japanese imperialism, our own Indian experience may not be race, but the feeling of superiority, the feeling that we are the chosen people. And then in the next part, when we say it has to die, we discuss the issue, we discover probabilities where can Vedic wisdom even begin to contribute something towards this race issue, and if it does, is that a very far-fetched possibility? Like, unless you accept this, this, and this, there won't be any solution to racism. So the solution part we'll see in the second part.
Okay, this is quite a contemporary topic, and not just contemporary, but it's a burning topic right now. And another way of looking at it, racism won't die, racism has to die, would be that something is not going to naturally end. It's like sometimes some weeds grow in particular areas. The weeds are going to grow. So exactly. If we just wait for it to die on its own, it's not going to die. But it's undesirable, it's unhealthy, it's toxic for the farm area, therefore it has to be conscientiously ended. So they will have to be cut conscientiously. So in that sense, this is, we could say, some things are natural, but they are not natural. Just being natural doesn't make them desirable.
Yes.
So naturally they will be present, but that doesn't mean that they are desirable, and they have to be conscientiously ended. So in this context, you know, there is a, normally often we use the opposite of natural as artificial.
Yes.
But another sense, natural, the opposite of that could be conscientious. That is, something comes naturally to a person. Some people just are naturally are good at words, or good at speaking language, or good at singing, good at athletics. Some people are conscientiously have to put an effort to become good at that. So here we could say racism won't naturally die, but conscientiously, it has to be put to death. You could put it that way.
Okay. So I'll just begin this thing. My knowledge is just limited to reading some dictionary definitions and, of course, Wikipedia entries. But I hope that, as you pointed out from that Stanford site, that experts today are not able to come across a single concrete definition of what exactly do they mean by race. So they prefer the social distinction definition, that when people are socially grouped together, that's like a race. Biologically speaking, it has become such a complicated issue that in 2000, another entry which I saw in Wikipedia, the European Union, they frankly discouraged any biological definition, because as we know, Europe went through its own hell from 1933 to 1945 with Hitler, Germany proclaiming the superiority of one particular race and the inferiority of other races. And a few conversations ago, you talked about the distinction between self-esteem and fascism. I really liked it. What was it?
Yeah, self. We could talk about self-esteem and ego.
Yeah.
And everybody needs to have some self level of healthy self-esteem. And it may be that we feel special. Not special in the egoistic sense, but self-esteem. In the sense that my existence counts. My existence has some worth. So yeah. Feeling that we are special is different from feeling that we are superior or that we are supreme. So the idea that each race or each culture, each tradition has something valuable, something special, even something distinctive to contribute, that is a perfectly valid thing. But to think that my race is superior to others, and that's, or that means that I should be ruling others, that our others should be subordinate to me, that's where it becomes toxic.
Okay. So I would like to introduce the point that the British conquered India, and it is historically proven that they didn't come to conquer. They came primarily to trade. They established a trading outpost. Then they had a mercenary army. Incidentally, that army also was taken from the Indian population only. They were just paid soldiers, mercenaries. And then they saw the situation becoming more and more ripe for their conquest. So finally, one fine day, the whole country was practically run by a company. Then the Indian population revolted, and then the whole thing was, charge was passed on to the government of Queen Victoria. So when they established the notion that because we dominated you politically, commercially, trade-wise, therefore we are superior to you. And they were successful, or to some extent, they are successful in having this notion prevailing even today, that basically they are superior to us because they defeat us politically. There is also another angle to this, that even though we were subjugated, there were some elements in our society who were saying that still we are superior to them. Like not the Indian example, but when the Romans had conquered everything, and the Jews would say that a Messiah would come. So the Romans would say, there is no Messiah now. The Roman Emperor is all in all. He's God. And although the Jews were subjugated, they would not allow Roman officials to enter their homes because they thought they would defile their homes.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
So coming to this point that like what I would like to ask you is, why does one race feel superior to another race? Is it because of IQ, music, arts, science, literature, or fine arts? Yeah. Do you have anything to contribute on that?
Well, one not such a politically correct answer nowadays is that it was also at one time to science. When the Darwinian theory of evolution got mainstream attention, the one idea that was propagated was called social Darwinism. And social Darwinism was the idea that just as there are different species, and some species win and other species die out, similarly there are different races. And some races are inherently superior to other races. And Hitler, there is a book, quite a well-written research book called From Darwin to Hitler. And so Darwin's Survival of the Fittest Principle, and Hitler's name of his book was Mein Kampf, My Struggle. So, and there are many ideas he derives from Darwin. Now, there's no, it, we're not saying here that Darwinism necessarily will lead to social Darwinism. And social Darwinism has been mostly rejected by researchers now, mainstream science. But the idea is that some races, it was thought, and Hitler claimed that it was the, his race, which he claimed was the Aryan race, was the topmost. So that means people can use different ideologies or different reasons for considering that their race, their particular race is the highest race. So it could be, usually it is associated with some kind of power. It could be economic power, it could be military power, it could be scientific power. So was it Rudyard Kipling who said it is the white man's burden?
Yes.
Civilize the other races. And now Hitler thought that he was actually doing something good by eliminating those races which were anyway not going to survive, and he counted the Jews among them. Now, taking this forward in today's context, the word the racist conflicts, primarily we talk about America, although that particular issue is there across the world. Now, if I consider in Australia and New Zealand, it's not that much of an issue because they're not so much plantation laborers or something like that from Africa went there. So you don't see that many African Americans over there. But it's an issue definitely in America. In UK, it's not that big an issue. In Canada, it's an issue, but Canada is also quite more conscious about the atrocities that they did to the native Canadians. So we could say that for practical purposes, the word race today is used, racism is primarily used in terms of the white-black conflict. And there have been different words also used. So to refer to the blacks, the word African-American is sometimes used, but that is considered to be too, first of all, too cumbersome, and secondly, it is not inclusive enough because there are many people who have never been to Africa. Maybe 3, 4, 5 generations ago, their parents were from Africa, or they might even be from the Middle East or where, not Middle East, from the West Indies or wherever. So I think black. So it's mostly in the black-white conflict that the word race usually comes in now. But generally, it's material power, material prosperity is in some ways seen as a rationalization for the superiority of one's race over others.
Okay. So, I would like to kind of wind up this thing about racism won't die. So, we looked at some examples you gave from around the world. So, would you personally be kind of disappointed the way some of the leading thinkers are that this is it, we just have to live with this?
Yeah. There is the whole view of social engineering where it's like human beings are treated like machines who can be engineered to perfection. So that is the reductionistic view of human beings like mechanical parts. So the idea is that if we just make those proper societal changes, change the government policies, or have the right kind of educational indoctrination, then people's views will change. And through that, the racism will go away. Now, of course, this can and should be a part of a solution. But the point is, when we use the word racism, it is often painting too large a group of people within one category.
Yes.
So, whites are themselves a large number of people. Blacks are a large number of people. Asians are a large number of people. In India also, there are different, not necessarily races, but different kind of regional designations are there. So, it's more a human problem than a racial problem. And there is a human nature by which often we tend to consider ourselves superior or others as inferior, and we come up with some rationalization for that. So race could be one rationalization, but by calling it like a, does racism exist? Of course it exists. But as soon as we say that it is an institutionalized racism or like endemic racism, when these kind of words are used, then it becomes too generic. Then what can you do specifically to deal with it? For example, in South Africa, they had a particular policy of fixed apartheid, and then that was removed. So yes, racism does exist, and it cannot be removed. It can't be removed entirely from people's minds because people are different. But if there are specific social things that are being done to cause discrimination, then they can be corrected. They can and should be. There should be proper measures to correct it. And in today's context, the excessive police actions against blacks, which has caused the current flare-up, that is something which definitely needs to be corrected.
Okay. So now moving towards the part where that's what we should really be discussing, that racism has to die. So has to is seen as imperative, urgent, important. So just to begin with a very fundamental understanding, what does Vedantic wisdom or the wisdom of the Bhakti text or Vedas, what does it say about if a person comes to me and says, okay, you guys have Vedic wisdom, you speak on various topics. Why am I born the way I am born? Can we have a correct answer?
There could be, since you brought this question, I was thinking of something else. But we could apply this, like the Gita vision or the Vedantic vision, at three levels. One is what we are born with. That means there is a objective reality to things. For example, certain people have certain pigments in their skin. I mean, they have a particular color. Yeah. It's objective reality. Then there is, so that can be associated with karma. Then there would be people's perception. That will be shaped by the modes. So, okay, this is the reality, but how much do I obsess over the reality? That is the perception which could be changed through education, through purification. And then third part would be that accommodating the differences or accepting and even celebrating the differences by looking at the equality. So now regarding the first point, that when regarding our starting point of the American Declaration of Independence or the American Charter of Rights, said that everybody has a right for equality, fraternity, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Now, equality itself is not a self-evident truth at a physical level. We are all different. We're different in terms of, like you mentioned, IQ or height or weight or any other material parameter, it's different. So what, and now why is this difference there? We could say that it is by chance, but then it just makes us all like all of us like puppets or victims in a cosmic lottery. And yeah, those of us who are, so that doesn't really make sense. So we could say that it is because of God, but then it makes God arbitrary. So the most rational understanding, where we accept the world's inequality or the iniquity and God's benevolence, that could be that it's by our own past actions. So we could say that by one's past karma, we are all born in particular positions in this life. And we need to make the best of what we can from the starting point that we have. And again, bringing this point, that with respect to the differences that we have, we could say that there are differences in race, and say certain races are more prosperous and other races are less prosperous. But even within races, there are differences. Like, say, within Africa, there were people who were born as tribal heads, and there are people who were born as slaves. And you know, the slaves that were brought from Africa to America, it is the white men purchased them, but the white men purchased them from blacks. So quite often, the black tribal heads or whatever they brought them. So you could say the disparity not just between whites and blacks, but also between blacks and blacks. That comes because of one's own past. And we see this even in India, where we have the caste system. Even among, say, Brahmanas, which is considered to be a privileged caste, there is a hierarchy. And there are some Brahmanas who are very respected and they are quite well-to-do, they get a lot of charity. And there are some Brahmanas who don't get anything. We have examples of Sudama and we have examples of others. Those spending Brahmanas are very poverty stricken. So a position in society is determined by one's past karma. And one aspect of that position could be one's particular race in which one is born. Any thoughts on this?
No, just quickly, what are the three parameters you used just now? The objective reality.
So the objective reality is the subjective focus, or subjective focus or obsession. The objective reality, the focus of one's vision, and then the translation into action. How does one act? So what is the reality? How does one perceive it? And what does one do about it?
All right. And you had something you wanted to say. So you remember that point? You said that I'll address your point first and then I'll take mine. So now you can start.
Okay. Was it regarding these three things only?
No. I just brought this up. You brought the three things and you said you had something already you were thinking about it. You remember that?
I'll get to it then. We'll come to it.
Okay.
If I remember, I'll get back to it later.
Okay, fine. No problem. Mm-hmm. So
any thoughts about this, about karma, what I said?
Yeah.
You have
addressed this question. I put an imaginary question by a person saying, why I'm born? So you have given me these three ways of looking at it. All right. Now, one extreme is that I see that from a social, biological, genetical, financial point of view, IQ point of view, there is huge disparity.
Yeah.
Where is the Vedic wisdom which will point out, which will hand over to me one substantial point of equality? Do you have anything which says that, yes, there is an inherent equality?
Yes. So equality at a material level is quite illusive. Equality is more at a, because at a spiritual level, in terms of an inner intuition that there is something within us which makes all of us equal. And in fact, this idea that there is a spark of the divine within everyone, as the Bible puts it, or that we are all parts of the divine, as the Gita puts in, this is a very significant insight. And not many of the races throughout, many of the cultures throughout history have operated this way. There are some people, you know, my particular race or my particular tribe is special, and others are, they're not even considered human. Hitler had some quite obnoxious words to refer to Jews and others. Dehumanize them entirely. So I talked about objective reality, but now in terms of this objective reality beyond the body, there is a spiritual essence to all of us, and the spiritual essence is equal. Sarva bhuteshu yenaikam bhavam avyamikshate. The Gita talks about this many times. In all living beings, there is one imperishable spirit. Or samam sarveshu bhuteshu achyantam parameshwaram vinashyatva vinashyantam ya pashyati sa pashyati. So one who sees like this sees. What is that? That in all living beings they are different, but beyond that, samam sarvam samam pashyani sarvatra. One who sees all living beings equally because sees the spiritual essence within them. So it is because we are all parts of the divine, because we are all equally the parts of the divine, because each one of us is equal part of God. So that our spirituality is the basis of our longing for equality. So that would be the grounding in objective reality. In terms of objective reality, okay, so we could have like four levels at this. Okay, one is in terms of ability, like IQ, singing ability, writing ability, there is no equality over there. Equality in terms of ability, well, no, we don't have that. But equality in terms of fundamental identity, yes, we are all parts of God. That is there. Then we can have equality in terms of opportunity. And then finally, there is equality in terms of results. So, we can't have equality at the level of ability. We can't have equality at the level of results. But what society can provide is equality at the level of opportunity. So, for example, if there is a, say there is a sports competition, and say in India it's cricket which is privileged, in the West maybe it's basketball or baseball which is privileged. So, based on one's particular country, or one particular race, if some people are not allowed to participate, then that would be unfair. If that person has talent, then they should be allowed to participate. So I think in Africa, when apartheid was there, then many blacks over there were not allowed to be in the team. And then it was that there was other way. I think in one critical match, South Africa, they had one very good player who was white. But then apparently the government or there's some thing said that they should have, as per the percentage of the population that is there in Africa, you should have at least this many black players. So in your team. And then what happened? They put in that many black players, and because of that, they had to remove a high performing white player. And then they lost that match. And it was that the particular ability which that white player had, they didn't have it. Or this, the black player was brought in and had that ability, and that's too critical for them. So the point I'm making is that you cannot have absolute equality. Equality of opportunity means everybody should get a fair chance. But does that fair chance necessarily mean that there will be equality in terms of results? Not necessarily. So in the particular issue that we are, that is caused the flare-up, it is equality in terms of the opportunity to be treated fairly by the law. The opportunity, the law should not, the law enforcing authority should not discriminate against people of based on their particular background. That is important. And that is something which has not been, if that is not there, that causes immense anxiety, anger, outrage, and it can even lead to social revolution. So any thoughts about this four levels?
Yeah. So this is a very nice thing that I just noted it here, that ability, we are all not equal. Results wise, we are not equal. Fundamental identity is affording that quality, and also opportunity is also a field where we can give a lot of quality. Moving further down the road towards a solution, or at least a perceived workable solution, Vedantic wisdom talks in terms of yadyad acharati shrestas tatta deve tarojana. I'm using this thing in the context of good governance and connecting this with Plato's call it dictate or a request or whatever, that unless there are philosophical, unless kings act like philosophers and philosophers act like kings, we cannot have good governance. So, in my understanding, Vedic wisdom puts a lot of emphasis or weightage on the three, understanding the three modes. And when you have governance, which is predominantly sattvic, you have one result. When you have governance, which is mixed with sattva and the rajatama, the lower modes, then you have one thing. And then in today's situation, unfortunately, where you have governance, which is highly rajasic and tamasic, passionate plus ignorance. So let us begin with, how does a properly trained individual who is a head of state, and if he is highly sattvic, how does he see this disparity as well as equality? Before our talk, we discussed about the three modes and the way they influence your way of looking at others. So could you just elaborate on that a little bit?
When you talk about how this will affect the vision, if you want to look at it, the three modes, the Bhagavad Gita talks about jnana and buddhi. And jnana is more in terms of perception. Buddhi is more, the way it describes buddhi is more in terms of regulation of the senses so that one can act appropriately. So we interact with the world in two ways. We take in information and we act on the world. Jnanendriyas and Karmendriyas. So with respect to perception in terms of three modes, from 1820 to 22, Krishna talks about it. In 1820, he says that sarvabhuteshu yenekam bhavam avyanekshate avibhaktam vibhakteshu tadjnanam vidisatmakam. So avibhaktam vibhakteshu, and that which is vibhaktam is separated or distinguished, differentiated. So one sees the non-differentiated within the differentiated. That there is differentiation in terms of the ability, in terms of the bodily form that we have, but there is non-differentiation in terms of our core identity. That capacity to see the non-differentiated essence, that is the mode of good, that is vision and goodness. But in the mode of passion, what happens is that prithaktvena jnana nana bhavan prithakvidhan vetti sarveshu bhuteshu tadjnanam buddhi rajasam. That when one sees different people differently based on their bodies, that means their body is considered to be their essence. They have no essence beyond their body. That means people of this race, people of this particular color, they are going to be like this. That's more in the mode of passion. And in the mode of ignorance, it's not even the body, it's just one part of the bodily identity or one part of one's personality or identity. Yattu prasnavad ekasmin karye saktam ahetukam atatvarthvad alpam cha tattamasam udharutam. Krishnavad ekasmin. When you take only one aspect and make it into everything. That's what is vision in the mode of ignorance. So I would say that, say, like in India, some people take the caste system and label the whole Indian tradition as terrible. That would be a vision in the mode of ignorance. So similarly, to consider that the whole of American history is bad because there is racism, and that would also be vision in the mode of ignorance. Now that one part might be a small part, that might be a big part also. That we have to see from situation to situation. But that's one way of looking at it. So we need to be able to see the spiritual essence. So the mode of, now translating these three into our earlier discussions about the different ways people see things. Within the left, I could say that the left wing and the right wing, the left wing sees people as basically as an engine, parts to be as machines or mechanical units to be re-engineered appropriately. So they feel that the only problem is in the re-engineering. And the re-engineering has not been done, or the engineering has been done wrong. And the right holds that the differences. The differences are there. So we could say that both the left and the right in the mainstream version, they focus on the vision of passion or ignorance. And as long as it is there, then it's very difficult to rise to a transcendental level. So the left would say that these particular differences, actually people are just equal, or the differences are superficial. But how they are equal, most of the left is radically anti-spiritual, or it is anti-God. So they don't accept the spiritual essence, but somehow how people are equal, that they don't have a clear explanation for that. On the other hand, the right often focuses more on what they call it, the material order of things. And often they say, this is how it is. That this is the higher level, this is the lower level, this is natural. So then that also is we cannot deny the diversity at the material level. So we could say within the leftist vision of things, equality is a ideal which is often grounded not in spirituality but in sentimentality. Because how are people equal? That is difficult for them to explain. On the other hand, in the vision of the right, almost like the hierarchy, there are different people with different levels of abilities. That is, if somebody is failed, look at what they have done wrong. Don't blame society, don't blame the system. Look at what they are doing wrong. So for example, those on the right might say that there is greater violence against blacks because blacks call the police more. Or people are called more because blacks commit more crimes. Or the black neighborhoods are more violent. Or whatever. So it's like, again, both ways, the externals are equated with the essence. Any thoughts on this?
Yeah, I just happened this very beautiful statement by Prabhupada. Knowledge concerning the spirit soul beyond this body, that is our gold standard. That is what we want. That is called knowledge in the mode of goodness. We'll come to that later also. Knowledge producing many theories and doctrines by dint of mundane logic and mental speculation is the product of the mode of passion. So just to raise the definition, if it is in the realm of logic and mental speculation, which is because of the mode of passion, and knowledge concerned only with keeping the body comfortable is said to be in the mode of ignorance. So whether one race is subjugating another race commercially, politically, and another race is feeling bad that we have been subjugated, but if both races have the bodily comfort as the goal of life, that situation will never end. Like a merry-go-round or a Ferris wheel, one race is on the top for a few centuries. Because of their bad karma, they go down. Then they are subjugated. Somebody else comes up. After some time, they are subjugated. And the material, this roller coaster kind of goes on. What we are targeting is knowledge concerning the spirit soul beyond the body. And that opens a huge vista of knowledge where we can somehow come to some solution. So I'll just again revisit your idea of objective reality remains the same. Somebody is born because of certain reasons. And then the subjective thing kind of is where this person chooses to follow or is trained because of proper governance. So I'll just share that example and then we can kind of conclude whether this is what we can offer. Apartheid, the word is basically Afrikaan, that means a mixture of Dutch and English. It translated as segregation, but the government gave it a gloss saying that it is segregated development. That's what they would say.
Okay.
How much they developed is a thing to debate later. So that was apartheid, keep people apart. And now some people are saying that at least the leaders were religious minded. There was some bit of some peace and quiet and prosperity. Of course, whenever the black townships would revolt, they would just be met with police bullets. So there was the Sharpeville massacre and so many other massacres. So Srila Prabhupada went to South Africa when it was under apartheid, had a discussion about society and social reforms with one Professor Oliver. Later, after post-apartheid, this Professor Oliver was very surprised to see Bhakti Tirtha Swami, a black individual, becoming a sannyasi, which is the highest ecumenical as well as social order within, you know, the definitions of Vedic society. And he was very impressed with Bhakti Tirtha Swami's intellect. And he was happy to know that he's a Princeton graduate. So he brought up this point that how is ISKCON, basically, if we say ISKCON representing Vedic wisdom, so I also include other Vaishnav sampradayas, other Vaishnav teachers, but right now for the sake of ease, we can say ISKCON. But ISKCON representing Vedantic thought, how are you solving the race inequality, or how are you different from others? So that time, Bhaktivedanta Maharaj said, here in ISKCON Nairobi, we have a local Kenyan black devotee who is a pujari. We have somebody from New Zealand who is a temple commander. We have somebody from England who is a temple president. And they are all serving together. So now this was a physical experience for Professor Oliver. It is not like he had read about it. He said, how did you manage that? So he said, because these individuals have chosen to keep their material inequality where it is, but they have accepted the culture of spiritual equality, where they all consider themselves, first of all, beyond the body. There is an identity which you established nicely a few minutes ago. And pursuit of that spiritual equality makes them consider somebody's mundane, like somebody's good at playing harmonium, somebody's not. So that doesn't mean because he's black, he's good, or because he's white, he's bad. So what is happening today is two things in which our society is having absolutely no progress. There is no distinct spiritual goal which can be pursued in life, and there is no culture of training and education as to how one can transcend. For example, I think you only mentioned there are some people carrying placards like defund the police. Now we are talking about a very minor issue, minor aspect of the racism issue, that take the money away from the police. So how will they behave so proud, behave so arrogantly? But I was just thinking, even the American police are also equally victimized by Wall Street bankers. Is it not?
A good way of putting it. Yeah.
So they're not immune from that.
Hierarchy of victims and victimizers.
Yeah. So I think there was some social observer whom you mentioned that he's saying that take this George Floyd case as a case of brutality, criminality, but not exactly race. But today, because of the modes of passion and ignorance, people are not even in a capacity to understand how do we stop this. So unless we come to the platform of Sattva Guna, unless we have the understanding that there is an existence beyond this body which can be of a particular race, and secondly, unless we have a culture of training and education within that realm, and we pursue towards that higher goal, we can never say that racism may die. We may be resigned to our first statement that racism cannot die. But when we cling on to higher ideals or education and culture, only then we can have some confidence that racism must die, and this is the way to do it.
Yes, you know, for this point of Prabhupada's example mentioned, and how the first African, first black sannyasi and guru that was held in ISKCON. Just a couple of points related to that. I see the current protests that are going on. So Prabhupada often says that the mode of passion, if it is not elevated to goodness, it will degenerate to ignorance.
Yes.
So we could say that the current protests that are going on, there is a core righteous concern to it, for it. And in one sense, when we see brutality, there has to be a, if there is no outrage felt by seeing brutality, then there's something wrong with us.
Correct.
So, but the problem, so you know, at one level, you could say, anger tells us that something is wrong. But anger doesn't always tell us what exactly is wrong.
Can I interject somewhere a little bit? Anger is a hammer. It can hit something and break it. But anger is not a flashlight. It cannot show what exactly is wrong.
Anger is a hammer. But
so with that hammer, like people came down on the streets and then they saw that there was no police or there was nothing and people are very angry. So the only helpless things or objects or whatever were the shops. So initially the righteous anger started breaking that, but then the opportunistic anger of others degenerated into theft, and they thought that, well, this is good. Every time some people come, they protest, the police go away, then we can just loot things. As such, there is a lot of unemployment. And this brings to more police anger. So that's how the spiral goes.
Yeah, that's true. So there has to be, and in terms of this specific context, and overall, we could conclude that there has to be at least some leadership that is grounded in sattva, strongly
yes.
grounded in goodness and in spirituality. Then the anger that is there, which it can be prevented from going down to ignorance, and it can be used for some kind of social change. Now, in human history, there have been revolutions and there have been reformations. The revolution is where things are just broken down completely. I remember long ago in a class, you mentioned this, that you had mentioned that somebody is a reformer. They say, okay, you know, this house, that paint doesn't look that good. You should overpaint, you should repaint this. So that wall is not that strong enough. So we have to put some additional layers of the wall. But that's a reformer. But a revolutionary is one who comes and says, hey, this house, that's wrong. Let's blow up the house and we'll build a new house. So, now quite often, blowing up the house is quite easy. But unless we have a clear plan of how we are going to reconstruct the house, there could be a lot of problems that may result. So, we could say that right now, there's a concern, and the concern is important. It is indicative that we are not deadened, and our conscience has not become deadened. But there has to be some amount of spiritual guidance, or at least sattvic guidance, by which it can be channeled constructively. And one way I find to how to get to sattva, I'll conclude this point, is that to some extent, in an earlier session, we had talked about mythology, we had talked about the ladder of abstraction, going from specifics yes. to universal and then coming back to specifics. So, often there are specific incidents which happen. Then, after that, different people, based on their particular backgrounds, will make different generalizations from it. Say, like some people, the leftist might say this indicates a racial discrimination. The right guy, this indicates untrained police, or it indicates human brutality, not necessarily racial injustice. But whichever way we go up from the specific, when we generalize, ultimately, from the generalization, you have to come to something specific, something concrete. So what are we going to do? If we only obsess over the specific, or we come up to generalize, but don't come up to again make something specific, then it will not lead to any solution. So obsessing too much on specific incidents or obsessing too much on abstract generalizations without coming up to any specific solutions. So that is not going to really help much. Like now the current protests, are there any specific things which are being recommended? What can we do to correct the injustice? Now from our perspective, we could say that specific measures we could recommend is that, you know, everybody needs to, while it's the government's responsibility to administer the social measures, whatever are required, but at an individual level, if everybody could spend some more time to grow spiritually, to understand their own spiritual sense, then that could help each person to become the agent of change. Any thoughts on
it? No, you continue.
Okay. So, the idea that in the area of social implementation, something will be required. And we as a spiritual movement, we are not really directly into social administration. But at least at the level of individual transformation, we could say that each one of us, we may not be directly tackling those spiritual problems of the problem of racial discrimination. But at our individual level, if we try to become more spiritual in our lives, we try to ensure that our consciousness evolves more, that much more, then we can be a part of the solution. Not necessarily by protesting, not necessarily by condemning the protests, but by actually cultivating a higher consciousness by which the human energy for reform can channel itself. That could be probably my concluding thoughts. So anything you want to say, or should I summarize?
You just summarize.
Okay, thank you. So, we discussed today on the topic of racism. Racism won't die, but racism must die. And that it won't. Naturally, the human mind will go toward discrimination. But it's like weeds will grow naturally. But by effort, that kind of discrimination can be overcome. And then we discussed about how at one level racism, there's no clear definition for it. It's not so much in terms of biological foundation as in terms of social conception or social grouping that race is defined. And we discussed across the universe, across the world, how racial, some kind of discrimination has always been there. So what is the cause of this in terms of the Vedic perspective? Talk about three things. Is when we want equality, in terms of objective reality, there is inequality. We can't deny that. But there's the objective reality. Then there is the subjective perception and there is the practical action. So in terms of objective reality, the principle of karma can help us to accept why inequality is present in the world. When I talk about equality, we talk about equality in four terms. Equality in terms of fundamental identity. Yes, we are all spiritual beings. We are all the spark of the divine in each one of us. The equality in terms of ability, that is just not there. It can't be there. Equality in terms of opportunity, that must be implemented. That has to be at the social level. And so equality in terms of results, that is also not going to result because people are different. So we could say that equality in terms of identity is something which we can cultivate at an individual level. Equality in terms of opportunity is something which has to be cultivated as provided at a social level by the government, by social action. And then he talked about three modes in terms of perception. And this, so the mode of goodness sees the spiritual essence. The mode of passion sees just the body as the essence. And the mode of ignorance sees only one particular attribute as the essence. And then you quoted from Prabhupada how if we are looking for bodily comforts alone, then whatever we are doing is unenlightened, is uninformed. Yeah. And Just as anger degenerates, the mode of passion degenerates to ignorance, so the energy of protest will degenerate unless it is spiritually guided. And both the left and the right, at one level, are fixated in the mode of passion. And if for sustainable change has to be there, then there has to be that understanding of one's spiritual identity. And then and there is a spiritual purpose being pursued. So then, at least that social guidance, when it comes from the platform Sattva, that can channel the energy constructively. Now, whether that happens or not is not in our control, but what we can do is, we can at an individual level cultivate our own spiritual growth so that we act more spiritually, more wisely in such situations when we are confronted by it. Anything else?
Nicely covered.
Thank you very much. This is quite a stimulating discussion.
Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Thank you.